Wow, the music comes down. This is almost professional. This is really nice. Welcome to Studio 5, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Steve Rashid, and together with my wife, Bea, who is right over there laughing, we are the artistic directors of this space, and we're happy to be here. We're thrilled that you are here. Thanks. We are back in the saddle here. This is our first show back. This for kind of the start, the kickoff of our fall season. We did shows up through into July, and then took some time off to take care of a few things, do a little bit of traveling, and we're back. We're happy to be back, and we have a really full schedule. Usually, when I come up here, I introduce the act and I talk about what's coming up next week. This time, I'm really just going to suggest that you check out our website because there's so many things coming up. I'm going to start getting lost myself in the description, but I will draw your attention to one thing, and that is we're starting as part of, we do these live jazz, for anybody who hasn't been here before or is kind of new to this whole thing, I will tell you a couple things about the series. Mostly on Friday nights, we're going to do this thing called Live at Studio 5, which is jazz shows like this. And Sam, I don't know if I, am I coming through the monitors or something? I'm just about to feedback, I can feel it. Got it? Thanks. We're doing these Live at Studio 5 things that are live jazz shows, and we record them. We do live video of the whole thing, as well as live audio. Afterwards, I take it back to my studio and edit them down to one-hour episodes, and they become part of a radio show called Chicago Jazz Live on the great WDCB. It's a wonderful radio station here in Chicago, which is our jazz station here in town, and we're very grateful for them, both for their existence and for the fact that they give us a voice and voice to local Chicago jazz artists. So all the shows that you come to see here are recorded and edited, and you're part of a studio audience for this radio show. And the shows air on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 8 p.m. at WDCB. So that's going to be our regular thing on through the fall. We're booked all the way into December. Most Fridays that are available to us are booked. So we're in really good shape with some really diverse programming, and several of the artists who will be coming up in weeks to come are here in the audience, so we'll talk about them a little later. In addition to the things on Fridays, we are going to start another thing called Dance Through the Decades. And Dance Through the Decades is going to pair up, as you may know, this is part of a dance center, my wife's dance center, Dance Center Evanston. And we're going to pair up events combining dance and music. And so if you can imagine a great band playing music of the 1920s, and then coming out and dancing to that music of the 1920s. And to facilitate that, we're going to have a dance class on the week before that's going to teach you how to Charleston. And so you can come on a Sunday evening, come and have an hour and a half long dance class with someone who really knows the stuff, and just very loose and easy, fun time to kind of get your feet together on a couple of steps. And then the following week, you can come in to a live band, dance some of those steps. And so that's going to be Dance Through the Decades. And that's going to start later in September. We're actually kind of finagling a couple dates right now. But look at our calendar for that. So anyway, that's all I'm going to tell you about what's coming up in the future. Our website is very simple. It's Studio 5. It's a word studio, the number 5, .dance. Not .com or .org, .dance. Okay. So that's enough of that. I will be back a little later in the top of the second set to do a little Q&A with the fellows. It becomes all part of the radio show, but we get to know the fellows a little bit better, get to learn a little bit about their music, some of their influences, and things like that. But for now, you're in for a real treat. Don Stiernberg is my oldest and dearest pal. And I mean that sincerely. We went to college together. We had a band together in college. And after we graduated, Don graduated ahead of me. He's much older than I am. He moved to the Chicago area, and I followed him down here, and that's what brought me to Chicago. And so we're still causing trouble together decades later. And he's here with a wonderful, wonderful quartet of all great musicians. So I'm looking forward to that. One final thing. It is Glenn Leslie's birthday, I heard. So I'd like to wish Glenn a happy birthday. Glenn is a good pal of ours, and I've talked to the band, Glenn. We're going to turn up really loud so you can hear it. Anyway, happy birthday, Glenn. And I think that's it. I'm going to get out of here. Bea, anything else I need to say? Sure. If you make calls, text through the whole thing, please. Keep your ringers on full. We love anything that makes sound is really great and welcome here. Bathrooms. I will tell you about bathrooms. Bathrooms are directly behind that wall. The way to get there is to go out this door and walk down the long hall and back to the bathrooms there. So, that's it. If you need to get out, the exit is right there. Thanks. Come on, fellas, the Don Stiernberg Quartet.
Thank you, Steve, Bea, and folks. Steve, I heard you in the back just now telling everybody to turn on their phones. What? Dude, don't even joke around like that. Cables and stuff.
It's almost like
I don't know. I don't think Chris Steele started off like this. Okay. Just a quick look here. Yeah, it's just as I thought. How are you doing, everybody? All right. I like to tell the guys because it's hard to see for some of them more than others, but it's hard to see.
So there's like 800 people. In F.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Almost like being in love, or almost like being at Studio 5. Call it what you will, but the famous old show tune there by Lerner and Lowe. And thank you all for coming in tonight. It's so great to see old friends and new. And we hope we have something on the program that you're going to enjoy. A lot of newer things for us, things that we haven't played very often. So we're going to expect your patience and sympathy all night long. And I trust you'll be very kind. Seeing as how I know most of you, I think that's going to be the case. We'll go right to a tune that's on our latest recording, and that recording's called Good Numbers, and we have one here that our bass player and arranger Jim Cox brought into the band. He found it on an album by Kenny Rankin, Rankin, I should say. And I gather from Jim that Kenny Rankin was well-known and excellent singer back in Jim's time in the 1970s. And, Jim just said, thank you very much. I'm just gonna fix one little thing here. Said they liked it a little bit out of tune, so we want to come through for you. All right, cats, you ready? Oh, this is a waltz, too. We thought when you play at a dance center, it's always good to start with a waltz, you know. And if you feel like dancing, just get right on up. There's still a little space over here in the wings.
One, two, three, one, two, three.
Thank you.
when Romeo met Juliet. Yes, somewhere I've read that old Romeo said, pardon me, pardon me, pardon me. Well, I think it's time we meet our drummer, ladies and gentlemen. I can't remember, Steve. Did you introduce the fellas?
No.
Oh, okay. No. Yeah, so one of them's kind of introducing himself right now, so I'll just pick up on that. I like to say everywhere I go that I'm the luckiest man in the world, ladies and gentlemen, and there's many, many reasons for that. But one of those is that I get to play every so often with these very guys. They're the greatest musicians in the world, I can assure you. And right over there is our old buddy at the drum set, Mr. Phil Gratteau. Yes. I'm on a stool tonight, ladies and gentlemen, because, well, Phil's sitting down, you know, to play the drums, so I thought I should probably sit down too. These other guys, you want to know who they are? Sure. Let's go now to the youngest member of the band. We have to constantly remind him of that, kind of keep him in his place. But we rely on him for so many things. He's a master jazz guitarist, as you've already heard, and he always knows the everything about everything. He knows everything. He knows who wrote the songs. He knows what chords they should have, and all of these things he knows in spite of his youth. I won't even tell you how young he is. Just trust me on this. Originally from New York and then Cincinnati, and thank goodness he's been living here in this area for the last decade or so. Mr. Andy Brown. Thank you. Thank you for Andy Brown on this six-string overgrown mandolin. Right behind me, also sitting down, is I think we all are tonight, yeah. A gentleman back there playing the upright fretless mandolin bass. And this is a young man that I refer to for many years now as everyone's favorite bass player. Many of you out here know why, because you've already been on gigs with him. It's such a... it's just a little more polite name for him. Yeah, everybody's favorite bass player. That's probably better than calling him the gig pig. Both names come from, you know, they stem from the fact that he's so in demand. He's played for virtually every jazz star you can think of, going back to his early years with Earl Hines and more recently. Right here in Chicago with Judy Roberts and Marian McPartland from Piano Jazz, many tours with Marian, Eliane Elias. Should I go on?
You got any more?
That's enough, he says. Everybody's favorite bass player, Jim Cox. Oh, hey, the next one is a feature for Jim. I'm going to switch over to the mandolin that we used to record this one. I think this is the third track on our CD. It's a wonderful swing tune by the great architect of bebop string bass, great composer of bebop tunes, Mr. Oscar Pettiford. And Jim put this together for us. It's called Laverne Walk. Were they having a band meeting back there? Jim and Phil just met, and so they're figuring stuff out. Yeah, they just met like 45 years ago. Oh, geez.
How about if I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and then we...
Perfect. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Thank you.
Jim Cox back there. I was telling him to leave some mandolin notes for me, but does he ever? No. Another one that we recorded a while back is a beautiful tune by the great Jim Hall. I know there's guitarists in the audience who are familiar with Jim. And I found this tune one time going to the, I guess we should say, another jazz club in town. And hearing the great Jim Hall. And I was really moved by this piece, and I've decided even before it was over, as he played it, I said, oh, I got to learn that one and play it and record it and everything. I just think it's wonderful. And I'm mentioning all that because lately I've been thinking that it's kind of our job as musicians, with everything that is going on and everything that's not going on, it's kind of our job to play something beautiful, I think. And this is the one that we offer. Thank you. This is the one that we offer in that spirit, and it's called Something Special. If you would. Thank you. Something special. I know some of us just met, and it's dark in here and everything. I don't want to scare anybody, but I know what you're thinking. It's just, I can't help it. I always know what you're thinking, and seems you're sitting there right now thinking, sure, they're great. But won't they do a Cole Porter song? Right? I think it was somebody over in this section that was thinking that. So we'd like to try to play a Cole Porter song for you right now. Whoa, this one has a lot of notes in it, Andy. It's 3 pages of notes. Mercy. This is called Just One of Those Things.
Right on it.
Thank you.
Just one of those things. 1930, when was it, Andy? What was I saying about he knows everything?
I was wondering why you were saying that.
Well, just for that, we're gonna feature Andy now. We'll put him right in the hot spot. Can you see him okay? I always tell Andy about his playing. You know, we've been playing together now for a long time. And I always say, dude, make it look harder. The people need to know that the stuff that you're playing is not possible to play on a guitar. You know, he has chords that he just made up, right? They're not even like real chords. He just makes them up. They sound beautiful, I think. Yeah. There's one right there, yeah. I can do that one on the mandolin, too. I like that one. Yeah, but I've been trying to get Andy to learn the jazz face.
Bitter jazz face.
Yeah. So that the people know that what he's playing is, it's like...
It's like it's so funky.
Yeah, he's getting it. Yeah. And then also think some of the cats have been doing lately is when you hit a really great lick, then you stop and say, what? Woo! Well, we'll see how much of that comes out in this next tune. Does anybody like to go down to the islands? Where? Not Rhode Island or Long Island. Not cocktails. No. Real islands. Well, this is one of those islands, I think, right, Andy? Oh, you don't know. You don't know. So this is Barbados, and it's by Charlie Parker. And Andy's going to bring it in and do all kind of stuff with it. Barbados. Thank you. Andy Brown. Yeah, you might want to be standing up for that. Yeah. It gets better. We'll do a couple more here in this first set and then take a pause just for a little while, and then we'll come back and play another set, and it'll be all different songs. I'm going to get the electric mandolin here for a couple here again. Pardon me.
Well, it's dangerous up here. Don't try this at home. I'm a professional. Well, so let me see. Yep. Yep, I knew it.
Right now you're thinking, sure they're great, but do they do any songs at all by Peggy Lee? So we do, actually. And well, just one. But again, it's an offering of ours, kind of for the times. We try to make everybody feel good. Peggy wrote this song with a fella named Dave Barber, who was a guitar player. And we have a guitar in our band, so we thought, why not? You fellas finding the skipped one. Like Steve Rashid would say, I called an audible there. It's a regular Trubisky, I called. Let's see, it's a new quarterback for the Bears. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to. I'm moving too fast for it, I can tell. It's from Peggy Lee to sports and politics in between. It's my apologies. It's still a happy little song. We hope you enjoy this one. Well, it's a good day for moving along, and it's a good day for singing a song. It's a good day. How could anything go wrong? It's a good day from morning till night. It's a good day for shining your shoes. It's a good day to lose all your blues. Hey, we got nothing to lose. Yes, it's a good day from morning till night. I said to the sun, good morning, sun. Rise and shine today. You know you gotta get going if you wanna make a showing, and you know you got the right of way. 'Cause it's a good day for curing your ills, and it's a good day to pay all the bills. Take a deep breath now and throw away your pills. It's a good day from morning till night. Thank you.
It's a good day from morning till night. It's a good day from morning till night. Yes, it's a good day from morning till night. Thank you. Thank you. One more quick one, is that all right? Steve? Oh, okay. You're there, aren't you, Steve?
What?
Are you there? The last track on the Good Number CD is the only original composition on the CD, ladies and gentlemen. And we'd like to play that for you now. I'm going to play it on the electric mandolin for the first time I ever have. And I also have to add that it's, I know because I wrote this, it's actually a very difficult tune and very hard to play on either kind of mandolin. So if I may, I'd like to have my applause right now. Thank you. So, I'm going around in the car with the Sirius radio for the last, you know, the digital satellite radio. And there's a really great blues station they call Bluesville. And of course, it's named after the great B.B. King. And I'm a lifelong fan of the great B.B. King. And on that station, they play his records a lot. And he's the, well, they call him the mayor of Bluesville. So I thought, that's pretty cool. Maybe I should go political and try to be mayor of something too. So this song is called The Mayor of Swingville. Over here we have the comptroller of Swingville. No, you're not Judy Bar Topinka of Swingville. So we'll play this one, and we'll stop for a while and hope to see you. Thanks for coming in tonight. Here comes the mayor of Swingville. One, two, one, two. One, two, three, four.
That's Don Stiernberg, the Don Stiernberg Quartet, with Andy Brown, Jim Cox, Phil Gratteau. Yeah, yeah. Oh, thanks very much. Thanks to these fine gentlemen. Please do stick around. They're gonna take a short break and come back, and we're gonna do a little Q&A with them, and then they're gonna play another full set. And I think that's it. The bar is about to be open. I want to give a quick shout out to my good friend, who I don't know if is here, but Carney Manassian, who always sends over the most gorgeous rug. And so we're playing on another very expensive rug this evening, which do not spill that, Andy. Just kidding. Just water. No, I'm kidding. But anyway, so thanks to Carney for that. And I know that there are a couple of other, we've got a full calendar going all the way into December right now, and a couple of the musicians who are going to be here later in the year are here tonight. I know Libby York is here. I know Bob Long and Al Day are here. Raise your hands if you could, and if any of you have questions about what they're going to do, please come see them during the break. Lots of other musicians here. It's really a great night for that. And so thank you all for coming. Thanks for supporting live music. We'll be back in a few minutes. Thank you. So this is, thanks for sticking around, by the way.
Sure. Really, I'm glad to stay around. Oh, you meant, okay.
Yeah. Well, you too.
Yeah. I thank him also. Yeah, thank you.
It's always a thrill for us to be able to do this and to know that we've got people that support live music, so that means a lot to us. It's always interesting for me when I have one of these gatherings of musicians and I come up, and sometimes it's musicians that I know well, or maybe they have put together an ensemble that hasn't ever played together, and that's kind of exciting. Sometimes it's people that have played together for many years. And this is sometimes the most awkward for me are the times when I'm up here with somebody that I know better than I know almost anybody in the world, because I kind of feel like, what else could we possibly say?
Yeah, we've covered that already.
Yeah, pretty much. And all the questions that I ask are things that I feel like we've been talking about for 30 or 40 years, like why the mandolin, who your influences, all that kind of stuff.
Uh-huh.
But I would like to go down some of that road with you again, if I could, just because I know there are some people here who may not know it, and even though I may. And it would be hilarious if you came up with all new answers to these questions.
No pressure.
For people who aren't familiar with your history, could you talk a little bit about how you got started? Why the mandolin over all the instruments in the world?
Well, that's pretty easy. Yeah. My brother plays banjo and guitar, and he's about 5 years older than I am, 4.5 years older than I am. So naturally, I saw him playing, and I wanted to play along, you know. And what happened with him is he went off to college and was a music major for a while, and one of his professors came along and said, he seems like you're interested in all this kind of music, you know, the picking. And I got this and thought maybe you'd want it. And it was a mandolin. Hmm. So
what professor was that? Do you remember?
You know, I don't remember.
I mentioned earlier, we went to college together at Ripon College in Wisconsin, little college, which is actually the town that I grew up. My parents both worked at the college. But I ended up going to Ripon College, and my good fortune was that Don was a student there.
Well, and I went there to be able to play music with my brother. We had a bluegrass band all through those years, and that's where I met Steve. Mm-hmm. So, I don't remember exactly which professor it was. It was either Doug or Donald, I'm pretty sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So there was
a
mandolin.
One of the music professors?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, one. I think it was one of the music professors. And there was another music professor at Ripon College who had a mandolin. He was the German professor, and I tried to steal that one too, but I couldn't. Somehow it got away.
You mean,
yeah, the guy who taught German.
Yeah. Doug.
He had a Gibson F2. My brother had this mandolin. It was a Montgomery Ward's, and those of us in the Chicago area might remember Montgomery Ward's, and their brand name in the mail order catalog was Airline, and it says handsome Airline mandolin, and it just kind of, you know, was sitting there, and so I appropriated it, and then, you know, kind of speeding along through the story here, I taught myself to play really bad, you know, I just struggling, I was trying just to get any song together that I could play along with my brother, and my mother heard an ad on the WFMT radio Midnight Special program, and that's the folk music program, of course. And she heard an ad there, and the ad said, "Study mandolin with the great Jethro Burns." And so she came to me, thank goodness, and said, "Well, little Donald, you're interested in this mandolin thing. Maybe you should go and take lessons with this Jethro Burns. I just heard about it on the radio." And I said, "Well, what's a Jethro Burns, you know?" And so they sent me, thank goodness, my folks sent me to lessons. not far from here at a place called Main Music in Skokie. And I walked in, should I tell more of this? Or?
Yeah, and you were living in Wakanda at the time.
Right, yeah. It was before the speed limit came down. And that was a good thing because I really loved those lessons. And when I was finally old enough to drive myself, I'd come down the Edens about 100 miles an hour. Seems like I'd get out of school and get to my lesson before dinner, you know. But anyway, I went in for my first lesson with Jethro over at the music store there. And he said, Donnie, play me something now so I can tell how to help you. And I said, oh, okay. And I held the pick like this, which is entirely wrong. And I only played with my, what I call nowadays, I call them the Django fingers. I only played my first two fingers. And I played very strenuously. I didn't have that good of a time, you know, in it. But except, actually, my first version actually turned out to be like kind of a Tourette's version of it. But I, you know, I scratched through that tune, and Jethro, God bless him, he looked me right in the eye, and he said, "Well, Donnie, that's so great." Can you imagine? And from that moment, I wanted to be him. You know, I wanted to get after the mandolin and try to be a nice guy, and because he, you know, he offered that support right from the very start. The second thing he said, he says, "That's really great. You got all the tools." Oh, man, so you're like 14 or 15 years old and you hear that from the greatest mandolin player in the entire world. I flew home and started practicing and, you know, ended up playing mandolin from then on. Tried to make my living at it all these years. And about maybe 8 or 10 years after Jethro passed on, I was thinking about that first encounter. And I realized, many years, decades later, I realized what he meant when he said, "You got all the tools." Mm-hmm. What he meant was I had a mandolin and a pick.
Not everybody had that.
He saw the he saw me playing with these first two fingers, you know. And, and he says, "Well, Donnie, we're going to fix some things." And he showed me how to hold the pick, you know. And then he started, "So let's work on your left hand." He said, "Listen, buddy, if you're not going to use your pinky, can you cut it off and give it to me?" I'd always wanted to have six.
Wow. Yeah. And for those of you who don't, I mean, you may well know who Jethro Burns was, but he truly was the greatest mandolin player alive, and he really did, and Don may be too humble to talk about this, but he truly took Don under his wing, and in later years, Don became Jethro's onstage partner and played with him for many years. I had the great fortune of meeting him several times because through Don, and I can also tell you that Don sounds just like Jethro when he speaks as Jethro. Really, and Jethro's playing comes through Don's playing very clearly. And I didn't know, I don't think you'd ever told me this story about that first lesson.
Well, you asked for different answers this time.
Yeah, exactly. I'm glad.
It's true, though. I mean, I wasn't just making them up so for different answers. But, that actually, there was another thing I said in the first lesson. I you know, from kind of teaching myself about the mandolin, I was also interested in bluegrass because, you know, when you get a mandolin and start playing it and you're a little kid, you go to the record store. We don't have record stores anymore.
No, I remember reading about those.
Yeah. We'd go to the record store and I'd buy any record that had a picture of a mandolin on it. And the first one of those I got was Mr. Bluegrass by Bill Monroe. Mm-hmm. So, and there again, my brother playing banjo and guitar, we both had just gone crazy for bluegrass music, and one of my heroes in that style was the great Sam Bush, who still is a great hero of mine and a dear friend. And I went to that first lesson, and when Jethro asked me what I wanted to learn, I said, "Oh, Mr. Jethro, can you teach me how to play like Sam Bush?" Can you imagine? So that's like the same as if you go to take guitar lessons from Segovia, and you say, "Can you show me how to play like Jimi Hendrix?" You know.
Sam was also a big fan of Jethro. So
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. In fact, their friendship began shortly after that lesson. I made Jethro laugh when I asked him to teach me how to play like Sam, and he just started cracking up, and he says, "I got a gig coming up in Kentucky in a few weeks." He said, "I'm sick of hearing about this guy. I got to call him up."
Really?
Yeah. So he found his name in the phone book, I think, and like a month after that.
Huh.
And that's where their friendship began, right there.
Did they play together then, or did they just meet him, or you go see him play, or?
They hung out, and they certainly played together at some point.
Huh.
I don't know if it was at that first meeting or not. But.
Why this particular collection of instruments? I mean, I know that you don't always play with a drummer, but mandolin, guitar, bass. Why that particular grouping of instruments for this? Because that's been kind of a steady thing for you for quite a while.
Yeah, it's a number of reasons. Some of the reasons are, you know, pertaining to the music business, I guess. Mm. You know, like it's easier to get three guys around than,
just the practical.
It's easier to. We can usually load the guitar and the mandolin inside the car, and then the string bass, just like in the Flat and Scruggs and Bill Monroe days, we just tie that on the top of the VW bus.
Yeah, I'm just going to say, does Jim just sit on it?
Well, he just runs behind. Some of the instrumentation comes again from my hero and teacher. He actually said one time, Jethro again said, remember when the pork pies, your band would play at the mm-hmm. Raccoon Club?
Yeah. Anybody remember the Raccoon Club? Yeah. Wow.
Well, in fact, we...
Yeah,
Jan Hobbs. And Mr. Bob.
We had Jethro as a guest there one time, and we did a number of things. And anyway, we're talking about one of those shows down there. I was talking to him about it, and, well, how did the gig go, you know? And I said, well, it's a little trouble with the... We didn't get all, you know, some of the players weren't locked in, et cetera, et cetera. And he says, "Donnie, you know, there's something special about just a mandolin and a guitar." Hmm. And it occurred to me that he's right. You know, and if you put a bass under that, then you've got low, middle, and high.
Yeah, yeah,
so
right.
So it's kind of all you need. Just like on your stereo, you know, you get low.
Stereo.
Well, yeah, what's a stereo? But, you know, those were the some of the factors. And then also for me, it's these guys as much as it is these instruments, you know. And that extends to the drums as well. It's like when I think about the good fortune of tonight that, you know, having Phil on the gig, I don't think of that as having a drummer on the gig. I think of that as having Phil on the gig, you know.
And
the same with Andy and his guitar, Jim and the bass, you know. They're the best at what they do, and I want them to be on the gig.
Yeah, when the chemistry is right, it changes everything, right? Well,
I do have some problems with Jim, though, I gotta say.
Go ahead.
Well, you know, he's heard all my jokes, and, you know, sometimes he has, like, really visible reactions, you know. Uh-huh. Like, he'll be back there playing, and I'll do one of them. You know, I do one of the three or four lines that I've done for 30 years, and he'll hear it, and he'll go. But, you know, in terms of the way he plays, that's what
despite
that's
that.
What.
Yeah, let's not even get into the hygiene and all that.
No. Well, you remember the first rule of show business, too, right?
What?
Never travel with a vegetarian.
Yeah, that's true. Remember that.
That is true.
That's a true story that goes back. That's for another time. Well, we're thrilled you're here, and
you should ask Andy some things.
Well, yeah, I would love to know.
Although he plays here every
Andy
week.
He doesn't know anything apparently.
What do you want to know, Steve?
Andy, you've been sick.
I have been sick. Yeah. It's true.
Andy, by the way, I like to give these guys a chance to plug any other gigs I got coming up, and you've had a regular steady thing at the Green Mill. Is that still going on?
I do. I have many gigs. AndyBrownGuitar.com. You can see where all the gigs are.
I taught him how to do that.
So tell me about the steady that you've got at the Green Mill. When is it?
It's every Thursday. I play solo guitar. So Jethro, you know, what he was saying about just mandolin and guitar, I've taken that one step further. Just the guitar.
Fine.
Something special.
I've been doing that for about a year and a half. You know, you guys probably all know what the Green Mill's legendary Chicago place, and they have two stages. They have the main stage, and then they have a little stage behind the bar. So I play solo guitar for, you know, like the happy hour on Thursdays, 5 to 8 every week up there, making a fool out of myself. So come by.
Yeah.
Some of you have been there. Sometimes special guests come by. Hopefully Don will come sometime with his mandolin and play, and singers sit in. It's always a good time.
Do you have do either of you have anything else of note coming up that you'd want to mention to the crowd so that they know about it?
Did we have that tour of all the Citgo stations in Florida coming up?
That's in 2018, I think.
Oh, that's
made
right.
It ahead of the hurricane.
Yeah, that's next year. Yeah.
You have that to look forward to.
We're booked way in advance. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's not going anywhere. I think I'll get out of the way and let these guys play some more music for you. Thanks so much for sticking around, and we have 50% of the band, so apparently...
Well, first, before we go, before he exits the stage, I'd like to personally thank Steve for making all this possible.
Yeah, Steve.
It's our playground. I couldn't be happier than to have these guys here to play in it, so...
Yeah, Steve and Bea, what a job they've done putting it all together, and we're so grateful for the opportunity.
Thanks. Carry on, fellas.
That was kind of fun. Maybe you guys have questions. No, I'm just kidding. We'll try to play some more for you.
Although I did.
How many people are still here? If you're here, oh yeah, see? 810, 820.
Something like that.
So thinking about the opening of this set, kind of reminiscing a little bit with Steve, I decided to try to play a song that he and I did in a band together, that one that we had in college. And which was, now looking back, when was that? That would be about years ago. That's a bit I learned from Jim, by the way. It's about years ago. And the song is from way before that even. This is a Louis Armstrong song. Kind of tells a true story for us. It's called Swing Net Music. Steve and I played it in college. These guys have never played it ever before. And so I hope you'll be there for us. Andy just says, I didn't need any college.
Ready? 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Thank you.
it's a thrill. My feet won't keep still. I feel such a thrill when they swing that music. Music like that puts me in a trance. You can't blame me for wanting to dance. From what I understand, it must be just grand to play in a band. When they swing that music, I'm as happy as I can be. When they swing that music for me. Such a thrill when they swing that music. Music like that puts you in a trance. You can't blame me for wanting to dance. From what I understand, it must be just grand to play in a band where they swing that music. I'm as happy as I can be when they swing that music for me. Yes, I'm as happy as I can be when they swing that.
Music for me.
you. Oh, if you want to hear that number done right, you should hear the recession 7, right? You guys handle that one. Yeah. Andy's wonderful wife, Petra Van Nau, is one of the greatest jazz singers around anywhere, and she does that one too. Maybe at the, Steve, is the 1920s dance going to have that band? Oh, the 30s is going to be the Recession 7. Don't miss that one, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we'll try another kind of new one for us, if it's okay. It seems with each record that made the last three or four, they always seem to have a Harold Arlen song on them, and they always seem to have a Ray Noble song on them. And in fact, we're starting to run out of tunes by each of those guys. But I found this one. Not sure where I found it, but there's a Ray Noble song that we hadn't gotten to yet. And it's called The Touch of Your Lips. I think I'll play it in, fellers, and then see what happens after that. It's a pretty song about love. Beautiful, beautiful song of love, as we say. Thank you.
such tenderness lies in their soft caress. My heart forgets to be the touch of your hand.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Ray Noble, one of my favorite writers, and of course that song has been done by a lot of great singers. One version that I was referring to there was Tony Bennett, and I like to, in every set that we do, you know, everywhere we go around the country, around the world, I always like to include at least one number associated with Tony Bennett. Mostly because of the strong physical resemblance that I bear to. It's wonderful. It's well, let's see. Let's call an audible here. I think it's time now, ladies and gentlemen, for the country music part of the show, and in our quartet, what that means is, well, music from other countries, and we'd like to do one now that is kind of Brazilian in nature. No, it's not kind of Brazilian, it's entirely Brazilian, and there's, in Brazil, they have actually a mandolin tradition, style of music called choro, C-H-O-R-O. And this is a tune that gets done in that style sometimes, also as a bossa nova. The name of it is Estamos Ai. AI, I hope I'm pronouncing that. And oddly enough, that's probably Portuguese, even though it sounds like Spanish. In any event, it means we are here. So I thought that was a true story. And we should do it, you know. We are here. Yeah, this one isn't. Let me see if I got the music right for this. Actually, we have it in two different keys, so we'll do it in two different keys. I'll start it in G. Do you want to play the G one? I'll start it in D for Don, and then you don't want to play it at all.
I don't want to play the melody. You play the melody.
Sorry, folks. You'll see us having these band meetings from time to time, and we don't mean to leave you out of anything by any means. But you know, we'll have these little discussions, and sometimes we may even erupt into spontaneous laughter. And it's not that anything's funny, except for the idea of grown men making their living like this. Okay, Estamos Ai. No, the D one is first. I'll tell you what, I'll do the D and the G, and then you come in on the, and then we'll keep all the blowing in D.
So D, G, back to D.
Yeah. arrangements while you wait. Phil, by the way, is a specialist in the Brazilian rhythm styles. That's one reason why I wanted to try this one, since he's here to help us make it through. One, two, one, two, three. Thank you. right. Estamos ahí. There's a great recorded version of that by our dear friends, Two for Brazil. If you remember Paulinho Garcia. He lives over in L.A. now, but I think he'll probably be back here to play on the schedule, I would think, along with his partner in the Brazilian music, Greg Fishman. They have a nice record of that one. Mandolin player spends half of his life tuning, and the other half playing out of tune. Let's go back to the 1960s, shall we? I know, it was, well, you know, speaking for myself, I think for just about all of us here, it's definitely before my time, but I read that it was a very rich era in terms of music and films, and so I've done a little research about that era. And found a couple of tunes that we'd like to play. They're beautiful tunes, I might add. So much so that I want to get them right. Like, I give my signals to the guys now. Can anybody imitate Michael Caine? You do Michael Caine? Yeah, I don't either. I think he was in this movie. Again, I just read about it in a history book. But, see if you remember this one.
It's a ballad, you fellas.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Thank you very much. Two from the 60s here, Alfie by Burt Bacharach, and then On a Clear Day by that other fellow around 1962. It's been Andy Brown on the guitar, ladies and gentlemen. Jim Cox on the bass. Phil Gratteau on the drums. And Don Stiernberg on the mandolin, thank you very much. Thank you so much. We'll just play one last little quick bebop number as you make your way. Unless, Steve, were you going to say anything else to the nice folks?
No.
All right. So, really, we can't thank you enough for coming in tonight. We're just going to play one more number just for our own self, but if you want to hang out, that's perfectly fine. As long as I can find it, here it is. Tune written about our little band here, it's called Four Brothers. Well, no, it's actually written, isn't that sweet to say something like that? this is a kind of original bebop music, or maybe even pre-bop. Back from the Woody Herman herd. I heard some things. It's by Jimmy Giuffre, and it's Four Brothers. Can't thank you enough, folks. See you next time. One, two.
Thank you.
So long, everybody.
That's Andy Brown on the guitar, Jim Cox on the bass, Phil Gratteau on the drums, and of course, Don Stiernberg on the mandolin. Thank you all for sticking around. Thanks for sticking around to the last drop. You all get gold stars again this evening. And please keep in touch. We've got a sign-up sheet over there if you'd like to sign up for our mailing list if you're not on it already. We do have a full calendar going on into December now. Next week, we've got a wonderful, speaking of the Brazilian music that Don played, we've got a wonderful choro group coming next week, led by flutist Julie Coyden. Got some Brazilian music, which would be really wonderful. That's a week from tonight, and on and on and on. So please check it out. And,
hey, Steve.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. Key of F. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Glenn Leslie, dear Glenn. Happy birthday to you.
There we go. All right.
Now
happy
back to our regular
Leslie. Thanks very much, folks.